You're listening to the audio production of Chasing Grace, What the Quarter Mile Has Taught Me About God and Life by Sanya Richards-Ross, published by Zondervan and read by the author.
To Coach Hart, I am eternally grateful our paths crossed, as your dedication to being the very best at what you do aligns perfectly with making my dreams a reality. The golden moments we've shared on the track pale in comparison to the memories we've made and the life lessons you've taught me. Thank you for the four P's. They made me the best 400-meter runner in U.S. history and gave me a roadmap to navigate through life with God. The track has always been my safe haven, my sanctuary, my place of peace. I've always said I didn't choose the quarter mile, but it chose me. Over time, I learned to love the race. One full lap around the track, and my favorite part is the last 100 meters off the final curve. I feel free. I feel liberated. Then, in an instant, a heartbeat, the freedom can turn to panic. When you sense the other bodies charging around you, and you're not sure if you're in position to win, strategy is overtaken by intense desire. Be first. If you have to dive, fall, or hurl your body across the finish line, you'll do whatever it takes. It's an instinct that's within you. But after making it through the tape, you have to wait. And you wait in faith. When I won the Olympic gold medal at the 2012 London Olympics, I wasn't 100% sure I crossed the finish line first. In the few seconds between the end of the race and the announcement of the winner, I wanted to will my name to the top of the scoreboard, but I could only clasp my hands in prayer and believe all my hard work would be rewarded. The photo finish showed I won comfortably, by a stride's length, but in the race's final moments, I still felt the need to dip my left shoulder and stretch my neck out over the line. Even to this day, when I see my right arm punching through the air, I don't know whether it's in celebration or a last-second reach to grab victory. As most people equate success with having more, my quest was always for less. For as long as I can remember, life has been measured in seconds. The fewer, the better. I've been running track since I was 7, basically a life's worth of conditioning to run the 400-meter race in 50 seconds, hopefully 49, or even better, 48. Instinctively, my greatest source of validation was being the quickest to the finish line. When I first stepped on the track to represent my Jamaican elementary school, VAS Prep, I heard my parents, family, classmates, and friends cheering for me. Sanya, a champion! Sanya, a champion! Everyone called out. I won, and my name was in the headlines the next day in our local newspaper, The Gleaner. I felt special. I was a champion. For more than 2 decades after that, I ran in circles around the track chasing that same feeling. It took a long time to realize I was of more value than a gold medal or a record-setting lap. For so long, I was just Sanya Richards, the athlete, and I hung my head when I didn't run well. My existence was all about my performance. Each loss came with a feeling of unhealthy and unwanted shame. Running, I had to figure out, is just what I do. It's not who I am. Since I started to compete at the age of 7, my losses were measured against the hope of greatness. Champions measure themselves against other champions. Winning was simply confirmation that I belonged among the league of extraordinary athletes. In retrospect, I believe my wins on the track sometimes led to losses in the race of life. From elementary school in Jamaica to the Olympics in China, physical, mental, and emotional confrontations have tested my character, my faith, and my resolve. It has always been my desire to live a life transparent enough to allow others to learn from my mistakes. I want you to see me as I am. Bear witness to my strength and weakness, highs and lows, goodness and sinfulness, my complete journey. On that warm August night in London, I lunged my body forward, not completely sure of where it would land. I only had my faith. Sometimes we need those moments. Times when we are forced to be still and wait for the photo finish. I believe life is nothing more than a collection of photo finishes shot through the lens of God's camera. For every exhilarating high like I experienced in 2012, there have been just as many, if not more, excruciating lows. I couldn't always understand how I could lose after I had trained so hard and competed with such focus. Eventually, I began to see that my losses were as significant as my wins. Every lesson I learned didn't just make me a better runner. Each running experience molded me into a stronger person. I could finally look back and see the beauty of God's timing. And now I can look forward and trust His plan. My journey carried me beyond the track. Through this book, I hope my stories will help you see your own experiences through God's lens as a life captured in a perfect photo finish. Prologue, the four P's, push, pace, position, poise. My strategy to running the race with grace. Muscles are my memory, and every memory a muscle. Years ago, when I started training with my coach, Clyde Hart, he divided the quarter-mile race into four phases. Coach Hart called them the four P's, push, pace, position, and poise. I work on each of the four phases in practice to ensure that when it comes time to race, my body responds as my mind instinctively shifts from one phase to the next. As I've gotten older, I still see the genius in Coach Hart's strategy. In some way or another, in some part of my life or another, I'm either pushing, pacing, positioning, or remaining poised. I hope you can apply these strategies and learn how to run your best race to live your best life. Push. Chase your dream. The push part of the race takes intense focus. As you crouch over the track, feet staggered in the starting blocks, fingertips bracing your body over the start line, hips raised in the set position, the mind prepares to go from 0 to 100. And that's how it happens. 0 to breaking a school zone's speed limit in a few strides. You push into the race with all your might. Sprinting is a power event. And with the technology of today's tracks, the more you push into them, the more you get in return. The force from my feet actually allows the track to launch me forward into the next step. Life, too, gives back what you put in. Every day, you have the opportunity to push yourself to a higher gear or achieve a goal. Whether it's taking a full course load in college, making time to exercise, or devoting extra focus to a special project, you are propelling forward on a mission. Believe that your persistence will be rewarded. You may not be able to see it or immediately feel it, but life honors that drive. Pace. Create your rhythm. You get out of the block strong, coming through the first 100 meters of the race at nearly maximum speed. But it's not possible to maintain that speed throughout the entire quarter-mile race. The body cannot push that hard for that long. At 100 meters, you have to throttle back and let the energy supplies refill with a little more oxygen. Your stride stretches out underneath the body and finds a smooth tempo. Arms and legs work together with the lungs to sustain the energy and strength necessary to shift to another gear and kick coming down the home stretch. Runners need to find a rhythm they can settle into. Everyone needs an awareness of what they can handle. The push phase sets you up to chase down your dreams, but pacing allows you to maintain your push for the long haul. Rhythm and routine set you up for greatness. Evaluate what your mind and body can maintain. Make sure your priorities don't cause your spirit to burn out. Check in with your Creator so that your vision aligns with His purpose for you. Keep your pace in line with God's. No need to run ahead of Him. Position. Go with courage. When you're racing the 400, you don't start to really compete until the 200-meter mark. As you begin to work the final turn, now is the first time you even consider where your competition is and how the race will be won. Prepare the body to throttle back to full speed. It's a snap decision. Decide, then go for it. It takes courage to execute the race plan. Coach Hart always said, most people will relax into the curve, but this is your advantage. This is where you have to start your kick. If you don't start your work here, you will lose seconds and you won't be able to make them up. Taking your position requires faith, discipline, and determination. Where am I going? How badly do I want it? Will I stick to my plan when facing struggle, pain, fear, and doubt? Evaluate all of these factors as you decide what you want out of life and what it requires to get there. Poise. Commit to the finish. The final 100 meters of the race test your mind even more than your muscle. Remember to stay poised, because if you panic and lose your head, you're not going to win, even if the other phases are executed perfectly. At this point in the race, you feel fatigue. It's only natural. Sometimes runners lose their form and start to flail. Losing your form is just like stopping or even going backward. Just hold your course. Don't let the mind convince the body it's failing and distract you from winning the prize. Hold on to your faith. Believe you did all the things right, and it's going to pay off. By this point, all the hard work is done. You just have to hold on and trust the process. Regardless of the outcome, be grateful and proud of your results. Pray, the silent, constant, invisible P. Prayer is an essential element of every phase, and it does deserve practice. Every journey's beginning, middle, and end is richer and sweeter when shared with God. When you pray, you ask God to intervene and then submit to His will. Through gratitude and admission, you ask Him to take away your burdens, and by your faithfulness, trust Him to do it. Prayer frees you from worry, doubt, and fear. Prayer fills you with hope and reminds you of your greater purpose. Not to win races or make more money, not even to become a CEO or a president, but in all things, serve and give glory to God. Life on this earth, as I learned through running the 400, tests your mind, body, and spirit. And the most important thing you can do at every point is pray without ceasing. Sometimes you might struggle to know what to pray for or even how to pray, but the key is consistent communication. Open your heart and let the Holy Spirit work through you. He knows all and sees all. Push. Chase your dream. Chapter 1. Champion Girl. Realizing your talent. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Ephesians 2, verse 10. I'm the only one awake in my house. It's still dark outside, maybe 5 or 6 in the morning, and I tiptoe around the bedroom, being careful not to wake my sleeping sister, Sherry, as I quietly assemble my outfit. Socks match my tank top matches my hair tie, which also matches my wristband. I like to match. Show up, dress up. Look like you came to win, Mom said as she labored over my braids the night before. I'm ready to go. I'm 9 years old. Somebody has to get up and drive me. Baby, go back to bed, Mom tells me from her pillow. It's not time yet. I want to go now. We didn't race until later that afternoon. I had all day to get ready, but I looked forward to running like it was Christmas morning. Born in Kingston, Jamaica, where track and field is the country's prized pastime, I had no choice but to fall in love with the sport. Surrounded by murals and statues of track and field icons Merlene Otte, Donald Quarry, and Herb Kinley, I more readily knew their names and stories than I did our own prime minister. I wanted to be just like them. I wanted my picture on the wall. To me, there was no other option than to run track. It started in elementary school. Every day after class at VAS Prep, we had practice on our school track. Well, it was just dirt and grass. There was no rubber surface or really even a track. Our coaches spray painted the field with white lines so it resembled a track. But to me, it was everything. I couldn't wait to get there each day. It was exciting to realize joy and passion for something I really loved, to experience being good at something, to discover a God-given talent. I even thought the tedious drills that marked the beginning of every practice were fun. Before we could start running, we marched in place, our arms shifting as perfect 90-degree levers, and then we'd do A skips and B skips. Those movements were an integral part of our development, and throughout my career, I'd never start a training session or line up to race without warming up with the exact same drills in the exact same order. I did everything full bore, unafraid of what might go wrong. If I was hanging from the monkey bars, I'd try to swing too. As a result, I'd often fall and hurt myself. But I don't remember my youth as one of scrapes and bruises. I just kept moving, running towards whatever was next. The prep champs are contested every year, determining the country's best youth runners.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.